Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is amazing how we can go from 1 week and we're in short sleeves and it's 90 degrees outside, and the next week here I am in a suit and tie and it's October. Wow, that is amazing. I was doing some research this week looking for illustrations, and I came across this interesting tidbit from one of the fact-checking organizations that looked at, and they said that they have uncovered 201 sites, and they're certain that's not all of them, that are disseminating false information. All sorts of stories that end up being spread around on social media when people don't check well, and they're very disruptive. Some of them are designed to disrupt society, to confuse and anger and mislead people, to create divisions amongst us. Some actually attempt to disrupt the institutions, and others to try to bring down nations. This is difficult and dangerous. Now, why do they do this? It's hard to know. Some, it's selfish ambition. For others, it's conceit. Others want to burn down society. And some are nations who wish other nations ill. Paul points to Jesus and a way around this particular problem, and towards unity, and towards joy, even in this incredibly challenging time. And he was writing to a church in Philippi. Now, Philippi was a really big town. And it was it's a city. It's located in Macedonia. It's along a major roadway, the Via Ignatia. It linked Byzantium to the east, with Macedonia's west coast, where you could hop a ship off to Italy. Nice place to be. Beautiful place to be. And Paul established his westernmost church at the time, there, in that beautiful city. And Paul and the Philippians, they got along really well. They loved each other, as a matter of fact, but they were both in serious trouble. Paul is writing to them while he's in prison, and he is uncertain whether or not he will live for very long. And the Philippian church was facing opposition of their own in the city because of their Christian faith. It was not approved of by a great many people. And so Paul was worried that the troubles that are facing the church will lead to anger and dissension amongst them. They'll have differing opinions and they'll tear each other apart. That's what he worries about. He fears his church, his beloved church community, will die, just as he wonders if he will die himself. And today we're facing all sorts of opposition as well. It comes from groups they couldn't have imagined back there. Paul's day. There are many opinions out there. Many people are speaking, but far fewer are actually listening to each other. And there are splits along any line you can imagine, economic and political and racial, religious, you name it, the people will fight over it and be divided by it. And this toxic mix, these stories, these false stories that have been outpourings of lies, intended to divide people, to stoke anger, to create or confirm particular biases. In fact, that's something that warns me right off the bat that I might not be seeing a real story, as if it makes me mad and it stokes some way that I would feel anyway in my darker moments. I go, wait a minute. Or confirm some idea I might have. It's like, I need to check this out on another source, see if this is true. And it's creating the false belief that we can't work together if we don't all agree on the current hot button issue, whatever it might be at any particular moment. It usually changes from one day to the next. And this really could tear the church apart, as was the threat in Philippi. And it might take society down right along with it. But Paul's advice to the Philippians is equally important to us today. Paul, he asked the Philippians, he said, I want you to make my joy complete. Do this thing for me. Be kind and compassionate with each other. Be in agreement on that. Do that for me. You might not agree on a lot of other things, but agree on that. Avoid selfish ambition. He says, don't look down your noses at other people. Instead, He says a useful way to avoid that is to think of others as better than yourself and look out for their interests instead of your own. He says, I want you to try to think and act like Jesus. And he crammed all this into a couple of sentences before he gets to this beautiful, what they call the Christ hymn. It's a really beautiful description of what Jesus did. And Paul tells of Jesus tossing aside the powers of the Godhead to become like us, to become a human servant, taking on human form to humble himself, never using his status with God, his equality, to his advantage on earth, never trying to get out of something that needed to be done by it, being obedient to God right up to death on the cross, giving it all up, everything he had, to rescue us from ourselves. And God responded to this with great approval of Jesus for all that he had done. And the way this is written, Paul doesn't then afterwards say, okay, I want you to now do the impossible and be Jesus. No, he's not trying to do that to these people. He likes these people. Instead, he tells them to use Jesus' ways of thinking and acting as a plan to follow, a way to live your life, and a way to be like-minded with each other. If we all work for that purpose, then we'll all be like-minded and we'll all be compassionate. He's encouraging them. He says, I want you to be encouraging each other. I want you to be loving and humble, helpful to each other. Be compassionate the way you treat other people. So don't be judgmental. Don't accuse. And he ends his beautiful Christ hymn with a plea for his beloved Philippians. He says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That means be in awe of God and all God is doing for you as you work forward together. Take responsibility for understanding what you're doing on a daily basis. Don't let the suffering that you're undergoing embitter you. It's good advice for any time. Don't let it twist you and break you and divide you and shatter your church. Paul assures them, God is at work in you. So hold on to that. God is giving you the will and the ability to be like Jesus in your thought and in your deeds. You serve the suffering servant exalted by God for his obedience. So be like Jesus. With God's help, you'll get through it all. So have no fear on that account. Don't let your oppressors tear you down and make you afraid. Do this and bring me joy in my imprisonment. And enjoy God's good pleasure when you do it. Do this and make your lives together sweet despite the opposition that you are facing. And today, we need to stand together against these divisive stories that are not true, those attempts to twist our very understanding of reality, to poison our worldview. In fact, that was an interesting point somebody brought up with me. Says, that stuff gets in your head and it just changes the way you see the world. Don't allow it to happen. Instead, as Paul said, be of one mind. Work humbly with each other and for each other. Treat each other with compassion and with sympathy, just like Jesus. And you know, you do that, other people are either going to be confused or they're going to be attracted to you, one or the other. Also, he said that you can't have unity if you're working for your own pride and for only your own good and for your own selfish desires, instead of trying to pull yourselves up by your own bootstraps independently all by yourself. He said, be like Jesus. Work for the common good. Create unity. And the joy that goes right along with that unity. Enjoy it. And Paul is sneaky here because he doesn't prescribe exactly how this should be done, which makes this more powerful in the 21st century. He doesn't give us a set of codes and rules just to follow in lockstep. He said we have to decide how we think it is best on a given moment to act like Jesus in the modern age against the current opposition. And it's going to change from situation to situation. He assures us that God is continually working in our lives and assures us that, as it says in Ephesians 2:10, for we are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Now, God will save us. That is God's job. But doing the works out of love of God and in response to his beneficence, that's our work. That's what we do. Paul insists we must act with confidence, or to quote one of my very favorite television series, we must boldly go. Some of you know that one. When we do this, Paul assures us that the Christian life is a life of joy in the face of adversity. It's a life of hope in the midst of suffering. As we continue the work of the resurrected Jesus in this life, we unite for the common life together, working in humility for others, lifting each other up, working in obedience to God's will, following Christ's example, living in awe, which is the fear and trembling of what God does, and of God's staggering love, of God's amazing grace, offered to us in Jesus Christ. It draws us into a closer relationship with both each other and with God. This is a win-win situation. Working alongside God, there is much that we can achieve, even when we're facing strong opposition. I am always impressed by how much we accomplish when we're in crises. Church congregations rally around members in need. They find ways of helping, buoying people up in crises, often behind the scenes, helping people get back on their feet. I've seen it time and again. It's done humbly, largely it is done behind the scenes. Working in service of the person in trouble and never for ourselves. It's powerful, and it leads to joy amidst the suffering. And Paul was wise not to set rules, because there will be different situations demanding different responses every time. You have to be flexible. I'm always impressed how neighborhoods come together after a disaster, leaving their homes and going out into the streets, checking on neighbors, checking on what people might need. It happened when we had what they call a microburst in Downingtown, which tore the roof off of one building. It's just explosive downward wind. And it shattered so many trees in town, it felt like you were in a lumberyard. It smelled like you were in a lumberyard. Fresh wood smell everywhere. And everybody was out. Everybody was seeing what they could do. That's the life that we're going to. American Baptist Churches USA has deployed teams to Texas and Louisiana and Puerto Rico to help with the recovery work that's going on there, to report back what they find and what we can do. Next week, I'll be hearing from Reverend McJunkin of the PBA on where you might send tangible gifts, then how to get them where they need to be going. So I'll let you know about that. We heard from Richard Smith this week. He says he has food and water, the necessities to get by, as more people are being mobilized to assist. And he added one thing that was a real help to me, and I pass it along to you. He says, as he sits there and does what he can and largely watches his pool turn green, he says, I think of Philippians 4:11. For I have learned to be content with whatever I have. That's an example of the joy and adversity that Paul is talking about. So let us come together as a united community. Let's be like Jesus, and let's serve each other. And we have two opportunities to do that today. We've got a vote to hold and a communion to enjoy. May we find joy in our unity as God works amongst us. Let's pause for a moment of silent reflection.